Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning, and welcome to the First United Methodist Church of East Greenbush, New York. We are here the first Sunday after Easter, or second Sunday of Easter. We are here to celebrate our sabbatical day together and worship God together, sharing our joys and concerns, and receiving God's grace all together. Before beginning the worship, it's time for announcements, and Fred will share with us a couple of those announcements.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, many announcements. I'll highlight a few for you this morning. Reminder that there'll be a meeting tomorrow, April 8th, from 6:30 to 7:30 to plan the 2024 Vacation Bible School. So again, that's a planning meeting tomorrow at 6:30. Today is the final video in the Caring for Creation series. This will be today at 11 a.m. in room 16. This will involve a short TED talk to then discuss the topic, which this week is what happens to gas stations when the world goes electric. So please consider attending if this topic is of interest. A couple more. Our Bishop Hector Burgos Nunez will be in the district celebrating district days, visiting with laity at Shenandoah United Methodist Church, and that is on April 9th at 7 o'clock. All laity are welcome. And then finally, our spring thrift sale is coming up Friday, April 9th, and Saturday, April 20th. Bear that in mind, and
the Sunday after Easter, our choir takes a sabbatical Sunday, and they are not here, so we will start our worship with all to worship. Please stand as you are able in body or spirit and join me for a responsive call to worship. The word of life spoke, so we could hear the hallelujahs of the angels. The word of life reached out, so we could touch the hope which heals us. The word of life walked out of death's dread tomb, so we could follow him into life forever. We're going to sing and pray together, "Come, ye faithful, raise the strain." Only verses 1, 2, and 3 from the United Methodist Hymnal, page 315, and the words will be on the screen. Let's sing, pray, and meditate together.
Thank you.
Tracy is not with us today, and I'm going to pray with you the opening prayer. And our opening prayer, as always, is a responsive prayer. The response is Lord's Prayer. Let's be in the attitude of praying. Emptier of tombs, God the Father, you raised Jesus from the grave, so all fears might be banished, so the locked doors of our hearts could be flung open, so our quivering lips could declare what we have seen and heard. Bright glory of God, God the Son, as you stood in the middle of your friends on that first Easter night, come, come among us now, in this time and place, showing us that death and sin no longer stand in the way of our life with you. Breath of peace, God the Spirit, strengthen us so we may stand with all who fear life. Take our hands in yours. Take our hands in yours. Take our hands in yours. So we may serve all who are broken with grief. Inspire us to share the grace which has been breathed into our very souls. God in community, holy in one, hear us as we pray as Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may remain seated. We're going to sing and pray together. Light of the world, in the faith we sing, the other hymnal, Light of the World, in page 2204. Also, the words will be on the screen. Let's sing and pray together.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Holy One, we gather with grateful hearts to remember the blessings of your light and love as they flow through our lives each day. In this moment, open our hearts to your Holy Spirit. Open our minds to the truths of your story. Open our hands to welcome the risen Christ among us. And open our eyes to your glory, a glory reflected in the faces around us. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray. Amen. The reading today is from John 20, verse 19 to 31. It was still the first day of the week. That evening, while the disciples were behind closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they aren't forgiven." Thomas, the one called Didymus, one of the 12, wasn't with the disciples when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my fingers in the wounds left by the nails, and put my hand into his side, I won't believe." After 8 days, his disciples were again in a house, and Thomas was with them. Even though the doors were locked, Jesus entered and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look at my hands. Put your hand into my side. No more disbelief. Believe." Thomas responded to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." Jesus replied, "Do you believe because you see me? Happy are those who don't see and yet believe." Then Jesus did many other miraculous signs in his disciples' presence, signs that aren't recorded in this scroll. But these things are written so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that believing, you will have life in his name. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Judith. Every year, the Sunday after Easter, this is the traditional passage, doubting Thomas. He has questions, wrestling with doubt and finding faith. Everyone doubts, regardless of your faith or lack of faith. Certainty is almost impossible to come by. This is true not only in matters of religion, but also in life. My dad told me the night before the wedding, his wedding, he was 81.7% sure marrying my mom was the right thing to do, and that it would lead to a happy and fulfilling life for him. He told me I shouldn't share with my mom, and I never shared with my mom even after my dad passed away 15 years ago. He had doubts in the night of wedding. There was at least, as you see there, 18.3% of him that wondered what on earth he was doing. He said, "I should not tell mom," and I didn't. They lived about 50 years together until my dad passed away, and it was not my mom's fault. Most of us have life insurances, right? We have life insurances because you're sure. Why do you have life insurances? Are you aware that you will die next week or end of the week? No. That's the assurance. We are pretty sure we're going to live a long life and be here to provide for our family, but we have life insurance just in case that doesn't work out. We have doubts. And every time I go on an airplane, I feel confident that I will make it to where I'm going and back home again, but I often leave a note to my family and friends telling them I love them, just in case the plane goes down. Who would think, like, that was about a week ago, I believe, the incident happened in Baltimore, the bridge. That ship just attacked, that crash, and the drivers who were passing that bridge, they never thought that they will fall into that river and they die or injured. Who knows? Who knows? There are few absolute certainties in life. When it comes to matters of religion, it is no different. We want certainty, but God gives us mystery. All who embrace a religious faith, or people who say they're not religious, both of them are going to have moments of doubt. Doesn't matter you are a religious person or you are an atheist or agnostic. You say, I'm a spiritual but not religious. We all have moments of doubt. When I was in Boston University School of Theology Seminary, they told us, here is not the seminary, seminary, it is a cemetery for your beliefs. Some of you, you lose your faith. There are times when our faith seems ridiculous. Doesn't make sense to some people, birth of a virgin mother. What does it mean, Trinity? The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. There are times when our faith seems ridiculous and we have more questions than answers. Some of us fear doubt. We fear that doubt might be just the tip of the iceberg, and that if we allow ourselves to doubt, to earnestly confront our deepest questions, we might very well lose our faith in God. Some of us believe doubt must displease God, and so for God's sake, we cannot allow ourselves to admit to doubt. We say no. Questioning faith is wrong, is sin. We think doubting implies a weak faith or even sin. These notions usually produce one of these three responses in next slide. One group of people, some come to reject everything they had learned growing up and the faith that they were raised with, and they turn away from God completely. They reject everything. Like you tell your children, your kids, that Santa was not real, or maybe it's real, we don't know. But then they question everything, and then they say, no, it doesn't make sense to me, and they reject everything. They do not come back to church. Perhaps many people responded like that. That's why the pews are empty. Others suppress their questions and retreat to an intractable faith, a faith that is filled with certainties and is immune to questions. Often, this is a fundamentalism that offers certainty based upon an inerrant Bible and lots of reassurance that what one believes is absolutely true. They don't question. They say, it is what it is. We don't question it. Do you have questions about God? No answers. Just believe it. It's all mystery. The third response is, and this is our response in our denomination, United Methodist, we examine our faith. We create a space for doubting, for questioning our beliefs. And this is the way Thomas did. He had doubts and he questioned and examined his doubts, and Jesus cooperated with him. God cooperated with him, with his questions, with his doubts. We let doubt carefully examine the assumptions of the faith that we have held up to this point. All of the things that we learned since we were in Sunday school, or every Sunday we came to church and a pastor, a minister, a lay leader taught us something. They shared their beliefs with us. We question all of them. It accepts that there may be truth in the faith we were raised with while making room to question and critic elements of that faith, recognizing that perhaps, not all we believed in our early life is true. I think the third response, is the most authentic Christian response. In next slide, we see Gospel of Matthew. When you read it from the beginning to the end, it starts with doubt and questions. Joseph, stepfather of Jesus, when Mary, mother of God, when she went to Joseph and informed him, "Joseph, I'm pregnant," Joseph had questions, he doubted. And he went to his bed, he had that dream. Questioning and doubt are in the entire of the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew begins with Joseph's doubt and ends telling us that among Jesus' followers, there were some who still doubted the resurrection. Even after the other disciples have seen the resurrected Christ and report this to him, Thomas still refuses to believe until he actually sees Christ for himself and touches Jesus' wounds. If doubt and questioning was wrong, was sin, Jesus wouldn't tell Thomas to come and examine his body. Jesus didn't say, "How dare you? Go away." No, Jesus embraced Thomas' doubts, embraced Thomas' questions. Doubt is natural, doubt is healthy, and doubt encourages us to further reflection and a search for what is true. Questioning doubt is normal. Doubt is not the opposite of faith, but often leads to a deeper faith. Doubt and questioning are not the enemy of faith, but often a path to a deeper and more authentic faith. Thomas' doubt led him to God. Thomas touched God. Thomas touched the goodness. Thomas touched the truth. Doubt and questioning are not sin. Doubt and questioning are not forbidden. Doubt and questioning actually lead us to touch God as Thomas did. Questioning lead us to touch God, to touch goodness, to touch the truth. In next slide, I will explain to you, this is our map after Easter, after resurrection. We will continue the path of Jesus' disciples. We bring all of our questions, all of our doubts, without any fear, because Jesus embraced Thomas with all of his doubts, all of his questions. No fear. Next week, I won't be here. I will take 1 week vacation, and Colleen Ramsey, she will lead the Sunday service for us. But after I come back from vacation, if I come back, if the flight doesn't go down, if I didn't come back, I want to let you know I love you so much. I'm going to prepare room for you. But here is our path, our map, like the other disciples in Jesus' time. Next 6 Sundays, after I come back. April 21st, we will think and contemplate together, is there a personal transcendent God? Let's question our beliefs about God. Why not? The next Sunday, April 28th, we will talk about Bible. Is it the Word of God? What does it mean it is the Word of God? May 5th, are all non-Christians going to hell? May 12th, is heaven real? What is heaven? Is it a place? May 19th, when prayers go unanswered. What is the point of praying? I remember when my dad was on the hospital bed for 25 minutes, a nurse was on top of my dad doing CPR. 25 minutes. That 25 minutes was like 25 years for me. And I was praying nonstop. Tears covered my face, praying, God, give my dad back. Please save him. All of my prayers that day was not answered. What is the point of praying? Can we make a difference? Can we change God's will? May 26th, we will talk about why do the innocent suffer? What's the point of suffering? How can we avoid suffering? Can we? We will talk about suffering. We will talk about Job. So this is our map after Easter. We are the people of Easter. Yes, we celebrated our Lord's resurrection, but we do not stop there. We walk with Jesus and disciples to explore the questions, to increase our faith. So I invite you to join us in next couple of Sundays, six Sundays, seven Sundays, and let's explore our faith together. And hopefully after each Sunday, we will have a Zoom Bible study together on a Thursday evening. I will share more details when I come back from vacation, and we can talk about that question over Zoom. And I want to hear what you think. I pause here, and I invite you to join me for 1 minute meditating on Thomas' action, doubts and questions, and Jesus' reaction, embracing Thomas and thinking about our doubts and our questions and God's response to us. Let's meditate in silence for 1 minute. Gracious God, we put trust in you. You are our refuge, you are our comfort, and you are our strength. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please stand as you are able in body or spirit. Let's sing together. Trust and obey, only verses 1, 2, and 4 in United Methodist Hymnal, page 467, the words won't be on the screen. I forgot to put the hymnal, sorry. So please open your hymnal, page 467. See, I need vacation. I need vacation. 467, and we will sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Thank you. Please join me for the responsive prayers, which is inside your program and also will be on the screen. Let's rejoice together in this feast of grace. May the risen Lord be with you and also with you. Lift your hearts to God, resurrection people. We lift our glad hearts to the one who gives us new life. Children of God, sing with joy on this day of resurrection. Songs of joy flow from our very being on this day. How good and pleasant it was, joyous God, when creation sprang forth, great power flinging stars into the blue-black skies. Precious goodness dripping down the mountains into the valleys. We were created in your image, your breath filling us with your spirit. But in the evening on that day, we followed sin. We made wrong choices, poor choices. We followed sin and death on the journey away from your grace, from your love. Your prophets, Moses, Jeremiah, Abraham, Elijah, your prophets came with great grace, declaring what they heard and saw. But we remained determined in our rebellion. Though the doors of our hearts were locked for fear you would condemn us, Jesus, our brother, your son, came into our midst with words of peace on his lips. So, with those from every time and every place with whom we hold faith in common, we sing your praises forever. Holy, holy, holy God of grace and hope, all creation praises your glorious name. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes, that our joy may be complete. Holy are you, ordainer of blessings, and gracious is your Son, Jesus our Christ. He came, showing us his hands, which were full of your healing. He lived to stand by our side when pain and anger assail us. He spoke, proclaiming your good news of salvation, your good news of salvation for rebellious children, proclaiming your good news of love. He died, going deep into death's shadows, that we might walk in your lights. As we gather to bear witness to his life and death, as we celebrate his resurrection and new hope, we declare that mystery we have heard and seen. Christ went to the cross, stretching out his hands to embrace death. Christ was brought out of the grave, reaching out his hands to embrace your love. Christ will come, offering us his hands so we might go home with him. Hosanna in the highest. Breathe on us, Spirit of God, as we gather around your table. Transform this simple bread. Transform this simple bread into the gift of life, which broken can make us whole once again. Sanctify this common cup that it might become the grace of which we thirst in this and every moment. And when we have been nourished, may we go forth into the world, pushing aside the doors locked tight by the forces of prejudice and oppression, that all might receive your hope, that everyone might feel your breath bringing them back to life. And when we have come to the end of our journey, when we gather with our sisters and brothers, all the saints, around the feast of wonder and grace you prepare, we will join our hearts and voices in singing your praises throughout all eternity. God in community, holy in one. Amen. On the night our Lord was betrayed, on that very anxious night, on that very hopeless night, everyone was depressed, anxious, full of fears, full of doubts, questions. What would happen next? Jesus was calm. He trusted his Father. He said, "Friends, are you kidding me? Don't worry. Come, let's break the bread together. Let's eat. Let's receive our daily bread. Let God nourish your stomachs, your body. Let God nourish your souls, your minds." So he took the bread. He gave thanks to you, God. And then he broke the bread. He said, "Friends, this is my body given for you. Eat and remember me. I will be with you always." It happened 2,000 years ago, but he still feeds us. This table is for all. All are welcome to receive the bread of life. When the supper was over, he took the cup. Jesus gave thanks to God, and then he said, "Friends, this is my blood given for you. It's a sign of a new covenant between you and God. Remember, God loves you and God forgives you. Doesn't matter what you have done 1 hour ago, a night, last week, last 10 years, last 60 years. God loves you and God forgives you. Drink from this cup and remember me. Drink from this cup for healing, healing your pain and your wounds, your emotional wounds and your physical pain. Now, in remembrance of our Lord and our Redeemer, our Savior, we eat and we drink together. It is a grape juice. We have it in these trays. And also, we have 2 trays of regular bread. And we have 1 tray of gluten-free bread. I will hold this gluten-free bread and one of these regular breads. loves you. Bread of life given for you. Jesus loves you. The bread of life given for you. Amen. Jesus loves you. The body of Christ. Jesus loves you. The body of Christ given for you. Of Christ, the blood of Christ given for you. Jesus loves you, the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ given for you. Jesus loves you, the body of Christ, the blood of Christ given for you. Jesus loves you, the blood of Christ, the blood of Christ given for you. Thank you, John. That was amazing. Touched my heart. Thank you. Let's pray together the unison prayer on the screen and also will be inside your Sunday program. Let us pray together. You have done great things for us, God of great love. You make a way through our brokenness so hope might be restored. You loosen our grip on fear, so we might take hold of the one who cradles us in the palms of grace. Continue to make a way through us, deliver us from numbing fear, and grant our faith increase. In Jesus' name, amen. It's time we meditate with sacred music again. Hymn of Hope, and Carrie and Jackie will perform it for us. Thank you. And there are three ways to support our ministry. There is a QR code on the first page of your program. You can scan it with your cell phones. It will lead you to a page that enables you to donate with your debit card and also credit cards. The second way is you can always send a check to the church address, which is inside the first page of your program and also on the screen. And our amazing ushers always pass the plates. Let's meditate with sacred music, Hymn of Hope.
Thank you.
Carrie, thank you very much. That flute, is it flute?
No, it's a soprano recorder.
Say it again, please.
It's a soprano recorder.
Soprano, okay. Yep. Thank you very much. Beautiful. I felt like the Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall want nothing. And that voice, that sound, led me to the green pastures of happiness and the still waters of peace. Thank you. I wish you were my grandmother or mother and doing it every night when I wanted to go to bed. God bless you. How lucky Peter is. Please stand as you are able in body or spirit, and let's sing together, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Join me for a unison prayer of thanksgiving. Let us pray together. Holy One, we give you thanks and praise for your promise of new life. We thank you for these gifts as we offer them into your hands. May they bring hope and new life to those in need. In the name of the resurrected Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, David.
Good morning again. We have several new concerns on the prayer list this morning. Please keep in your prayers Dustin, brother-in-law of David Nadeau, the McLaughlin's friend Drew on the passing of his grandson, Jessica D'Ambrosi and family on the passing of her uncle Frank, Ryan Ledick, Donna Sander, Jean Cheviak's aunt, Paul and Diane Becker, John Hill, friend of Claudia Emmerich, Pam Martin, and I'll ask prayers for my friend Sarah Litke, a college friend now serving as a U.S. diplomat in the Middle East. We also have some joys. Three youth and four adults traveled to the Upper New York Conference Center for a mission trip to organize care packages. Our youth were able to provide 24 hygiene kits. Thank you for your service to others. Pastor Daniel will be enjoying a well-deserved vacation from April 10th yes. through 17th. I hope it's someplace fun that you're
I not. Go, thank you. I go Florida, Cocoa Beach. Amanda and I, we go, and we planned for going to Disney too. So we will see how it goes.
Okay.
What was it?
In a line, be sure.
Okay.
The voice of experience. Further, we're joyful that Gene and Chuck Cheviak have arrived happily in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And of course, Carrie and Peter Larson recently celebrated their 60th wedding anniversary.
Wow. <laughs> 60 years, Peter, you went to the bed with that. Beautiful.
Peter and Carrie invite everyone to join them in the fellowship hall after the service today to celebrate. We also have a few upcoming birthdays. Actually, to start, a belated happy birthday to Lauren Lehman. That was April 4th. On April 9th, Lorraine Beals, Mike Gizzo, and Tracy Haynes. And on the 13th, Amber Telford. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Thank you, Fred. Thank you. And thank you, our youth group. I hope, Jessica, you like that photo I added to our joys. Beautiful. They had an amazing meeting with our bishop. And thank you for thinking about me and bringing a gift. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. The prayer and meditation is inside your Sunday program and also will be on the screen. Holy God, we come before you in prayer, lifting to you the joys and concerns, the hopes and dreams of our lives. May we also be open to your voice in our lives, that we may see with new eyes and hear with new ears the direction you will have us go. Bless, we pray. Bless, we pray, this gathering of your children, that we may grow and flourish in your love and grace for the purpose to which you have called us. Hear our prayers for those whose lives have touched us, those who are in pain, those who are ill, those who grieve. May we touch their lives not only through our prayers, but through our lives and actions as well. Guide us, bless us, uplift us, and hold us. For we are your children, called to our purpose in your world. Hear our prayers, those spoken and those hidden in our hearts. We pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand as you are able in body or spirit. Let's sing and pray together. May you run and not be weary. The faith we sing, page 2281. Let's sing and pray together. Please join me for a responsive benediction. Go now to walk in God's light. We will tell of what we have seen in the glory of creation and in the goodness of those who love us. Go now to serve in Christ's light. We will share what we have heard in the parables about grace and in the laughter of little children. Go now to live in the Spirit's light. We will touch the broken places with healing, and we will stare down injustice until it changes its ways. Go in kindness, go in love, go in peace. Amen.